Hello, everyone. So for the next 30 minutes, I'm going to present a talk called Beyond Frontend. This talk is about frontend development routine and how it can lead you to become a great engineering manager. So why am I here? Right now, I am in the role of a chief technical officer, and I lead a unit of 40 engineers of different spheres like backend, frontend, iOS, Android, quality assurance. And my job is to be responsible for the technical decisions of my teams. But I started my IT career as a frontend developer, and I still keep in touch with IT industry by teaching. I already trained over 500 students in frontend development, and I'm really proud of them because lots of them right now are software engineers all over the world. So why does the topic exist? The thing is that when people start to know my background, they always ask the same question. Oh, wow, Alex, frontend, nice, but how did you end up here? How did you become an engineering manager? Because in their minds, right now, frontend development is still such a triangle where we do lots of HTML, some styles, and some JavaScript. Spoiler, that's not true, but even if it was true, this triangle should be reversed because right now we do lots of JavaScript, a little bit of styles, and just a tiny amount of pure HTML. Also, in their minds, CSS is always awesome, meaning that every style we produce instantly breaks the page, and that we are lazy enough that we still only use one JavaScript library called React. That's not true. And long story short, I'm going to prove you that front-end developer is, first of all, a developer. It all starts with tech. So right now, as an engineering manager, my job is to create new services and new product features in the services. A modern web servers looks like this. So you have a bunch of clients, I don't know, web browser, iPhone, Android phone, desktop client. They make some request to the web server. You have some black box API that fetches some data from the database. It somehow changes the data and returns to the client. You also have lots of cache to reduce the network load and the server load, and you always use some external services because you don't have the time and resources to write all the code yourself. In the next slides, I'm going to show you that your daily routine as a front-end developer helps you to understand all the pieces in the scheme. Let's start with infrastructure. For me, the result of front-end developers' work in terms of infrastructure is a bunch of compiled static files, such as JavaScript, CSS, HTML, images, videos, text, PDFs, whatever. And then somehow these files are transferred to the servers. And a front-end developer knows which servers they are transferred to. It may be the servers with the services, with the backend itself, like bare metal, virtual machines, containers, or it can be a specialized server just for delivering static content, such as S3-like storage or content delivery network. When you release in frontend, meaning when you transfer these files to the servers, you use several patterns that are common along all the functions. For example, you may use feature flags, meaning when the new functionality arrives, it's disabled by default. And to turn it on, you need to switch the toggle in your remote config. It helps to reduce the load, and it also helps to prevent big failures and issues, because if the failure happens, all you need to do is to switch the feature off and not to revert or cancel the whole release. We also do some release patterns as, I don't know, blue and green deployments or canary deployments, but the feature flag is the most important one. And also, in terms of release, when you are trying to deploy your files, for example, for one or two servers in a small project, it's okay, you can do it by yourself. But when the project is big and you have a great audience, you have hundreds or thousands of servers, and you need some system to make sure that all the servers got the new files. So you need some help. You may use Chief, Ansible, Puppet, or other services, and the great front-end developer knows the services and knows how to configure them. Modern web services mean lots of network interactions. And first of all, when you develop in your browser, you have your DevTools and you have a network tab. And in my opinion, Chrome tab is the best one. And you as a front-end developer can get all the network info of your application, all the URLs, statuses, protocols, I don't know, file sizes, timings, and other stuff. You can even throttle the connection or cancel it at all. In theory, on a daily basis, a front-end developer works with lots of protocols, with different versions for HTTP protocol, for example. 1.0, which was developed in the 90s, 1.1, which added head, put and delete methods and added keep alive to the protocol. 2.0, which became binary, added some multiplexing, server push, and headers optimization. Or even 3.0, that fixed the TCP head of line blocking problem and is written on top of UDP instead. When HTTP is not enough, you may use different approaches to create a data stream. For example, use a long polling pattern when you send the next request immediately after the response, or use some built-in technologies such as server-send events or WebSocket protocol. Modern web services have lots of media in them, and a modern-day front-end developer knows lots of media protocols, such as HLS or MPEG-DASH for video and streaming, or even WebRTC for, I don't know, cloud gaming and stuff. And the last one, we don't use it directly, but it's all over the place. It's DNS. It's when you transfer the URL to an IP address. And there are lots of new versions of DNS, like DNS over TLS or DNS over HTTPS, which makes it more fast and more secure. When we talk about network, we should not forget about the APIs. When you're trying to build an architecture for a feature, you as a front-end developer always discuss the best way to transfer the data. It could be REST API for CRUD operations. It could be GraphQL to make sure that you get the exact fields from the entity that you need. Or you can go binary, change JSON to protobuf and use gRPC instead. And you also use API software such as Swagger, which helps you to read and even generate API, and Postman, which help you to test HTTP requests by emulating them. And also, a front-end developer works on network optimizations. Right now, minifying your static files is an industry standard, I mean text files. And a front-end developer also knows lots of algorithms of static encoding, such as gzip, deflate, Brotli, zopfly. And a modern front-end developer also knows that different formats give different file sizes. And for example, a WebP image or WebP animation is much more lightweight than PNG or GIF. And right now, Nginx is a property standard for reverse proxy or L7 balancing. And every front-end developer knows that Nginx exists. Some of them can edit their configurations, and some of them can even administrate them. Let's talk about backend. First of mind is Node.js. It's a technology that lets you to write JavaScript on the backend side, but it's too obvious. So let's deeply talk about BFF, or backend or for frontend. It's a pattern close to GraphQL that helps you to create virtual backends that create virtual APIs to make sure that you get only the amount of data, only the fields that you need for your exact client, for your exact business functionality. It can be implemented in Node.js and JavaScript, or it can be implemented in any language that you can write web services in. When you speak about Backend, you also speak about multithreading, but as you all know, JavaScript is single-threaded. It runs on event loop, and how do we get more threads? That's how. You have a built-in technology called web workers. You also have service workers and push workers, but we'll talk about them later. Now let's focus on the web worker. Web worker is an entity that browser gives like separate resources. I think it's a separate process. You can delegate a worker some heavy stuff, I don't know, computing the P number. And a web worker by post message can return you the result, and you can use it in your main thread, in the UI thread in your browser. Let's talk about cache. Cache matters a lot in modern systems because it helps to reduce the server load and reduce the network load. As developers, we often work with cache headers such as cache control, last modified, or etag to make sure that our users do not waste their traffic for the common files, but also at the same moment they have the most fresh files. The last one is not commonly used, but I totally recommend to start using it. You can Google it if you want. It's an Nginx directive called proxy cache. The use case is when your static files are located in S3-like storage, you get charged for every request for the file. And you, if you have some common file that everyone requests, it can cost a lot of money. A proxy cache directive creates a folder on the same machine that Nginx runs at, and it puts a local copy of a commonly requested file. You also get from Nginx the xcache status header that in its value tells you whether the file is from Nginx cache or is straight from the S3 storage. Let's talk about client cache. With the help of service worker, we are able to address the global object called caches, and it helps your web application to work completely offline. So when you have no internet, you don't have that Chrome diner jumping, you know. You also may use cookies, for example, to save the authentication information while refreshing the page, or you can simply use web storage API, such as local storage or session storage. But don't forget, you should store there only insecure information. Long time ago, in the standard, there was web SQL, and you could write directly in the JavaScript SQL text. It is deprecated. It was removed from Chrome 97, I guess. But there is still IndexedDB. It's not relational. It's a K-value database, but still it is useful for transaction, and it's, you know, local storage on steroids. Such as with Node.js, you can use MongoDB using JavaScript. MongoDB is not only SQL, non-relational document-based database, and the main language to operate with MongoDB is JavaScript. If you are old enough and long enough in the industry, you may remember the mean stack, M-E-A-N, which means Mongo, Express, Angular, and Node.js. And also you, as a frontend developer, work a lot with analytics. You have some endpoints you send the analytic info to, but they are somehow collected in large databases, for example, ClickHouse, and you use some visualization tools like Redash. So you as a developer can go to Redash and write SQL queries right to ClickHouse. That's your practice. Every service you have, your backend for frontend, your Nginx, or even your scripts for files deployment should have logs. And you should have means to save these logs, to read them, and to rotate them. You can use existing solutions, for example, Yale stack. You can even make it more difficult, adding, I don't know, Redis and Kafka for more amount of data. But I recommend you to start with GQ. It's an open source library you can find on GitHub, and it helps you to sort, to filter logs in JSON format very easily. Every web service should have alerts and monitoring. And we as front-end developers are familiar with these concepts because we have Lighthouse and we have Crux, which help us to measure the performance of the page, the SEO performance, images, scripts, or, I don't know, layout shifts. So we are familiar with SLA, like, and SLO and SLI's concepts. We are familiar with Sentry, which is industry standard for collecting and working with errors and issues. And we are also familiar with Grafana, a visualization tool for technical information. A front-end developer is also familiar with quality assurance patterns. You may use instruments like Jest to have unit or snapshot testing, or Puppeteer and WebDriver for end-to-end testing. And front-end developer is also familiar with some services around the quality assurance. For example, Jenkins to run your tests, or Allure to collect the reports or store your test cases. Let's not forget about security. There is a list of OWASP top 10. It's renewed every year, and it's a top 10 list of the vulnerabilities that are in the web right now. The most common you may see on the slide in the web. CSP, which reduces or allows some external content on your page. X-frame options, which allows or denies the possibility to have your page opened as an iframe somewhere else in the internet. It prevents clickjacking. XSS, cross-site scripting. CSRF, that prevents a user to do some actions it doesn't want to do. For example, you can may show a user an image, which leads to, I don't know, deleting an account and stuff. And do not forget about a course. So you need to configure which sites can go externally to your site from the internet. About mobile development. Very often, business asks to make a prototype fast, and you do not do it in the native applications. You use iframe and WebView with mobile web. But you want it to look as native as possible, so a front-end developer is familiar with Google and Apple guidelines. Also, with the help of Web Manifest and Service Worker, you can create a progressive web application. Technically, you just save a tab in your browser as an external application on your phone. By adding a push worker and web notification API, you can create a native-like experience in notificating. About desktop clients, there is a technology called Electron, but I only know memes that it consumes a lot of RAM and resources. About design. As a front-end developer, you work with Figma or other design instrument on a daily basis to get your styles information, pictures information, and design stuff. But also, I think in 2010s and 2020s, every company still has its own UI kit, and you as front-end developers always have it in the separate library, and you have it with separate versions as a dependency in your package JSON. Okay, let's go with human interactions. When you are an engineering manager, you communicate with people a lot. And let's dive in your routine as a front-end developer and look where you can have these interactions. First of all, onboarding. When a new person comes to your team, you can help them to onboard. For example, to create some knowledge database in a wiki format or do some screencasts about your functionalities, because in my opinion, screencasts and video with people work better than plain text. And this is your chance to start practicing one-on-one meetings. I think it's a best tool for a manager to communicate with people in their team. Do not forget about hiring. Hiring basically consists of three meetings: recruiter meeting, technical interview, and soft skills interview. You can participate in technical interview, and you can help to make it better by optimizing interview questions, optimizing interview structure, or even optimizing feedback templates for the candidates. And the most important thing, when you start doing interviews from the other side, you understand that it is a very stressful process on both sides, and you have a very small amount of time, like 60 to 90 minutes, to decide whether you want to have a long-lasting work relationship or not. When your team is big enough and you are in a product team, you always have agile-like processes, and you can become responsible of these processes. For example, team daily meetings or groomings or plannings or decompositions. And when your team becomes big enough, it also has some virtual teams, aka feature teams, inside it. And every feature or virtual team needs its own virtual leader. And the last one is public activities. Please do not hesitate to take action in meetups. It could be local meetups in your company or external ones or even performing on stage. And please consider teaching, because the thing I learned when I started teaching is that you start to truly understand your subject only when you are able to explain it to a child. It's not my course, it's just a random screenshot from YouTube. Thanks for having me, and I'm happy to answer all your questions.